Our next speaker is Dr. Krishna Murthi Ramasubramanyam, a doctorate in theoretical physics who's been conferred the prestigious Maharshi Bhadrayan Vyas Samman by the President of India in recognition of the research work done by him towards the synergy between modernity and tradition. Krishna ji is here to deliver a talk on unique features of Indian mathematics and astronomy. Sir.
Namaste. The previous speaker ended his talk requesting you to wet your feet. Whether you are willing or not, I am going to make you do that. So let me start with an interesting anecdote which I happened to encounter. So when I was applying for a visa to the US, so this was I think about 15, 20, almost 17 years ago. So then there was a question asked by the visa officer when I went there. He said, why are you going to US? I said, there is a conference where I am going to talk on Indian astronomy. The next question was, astronomy is astronomy, what is Indian about it? So then I said, true, astronomy is astronomy, but the way it is practiced, the ideas which have got evolved, the style in which they have been transmitted to us, and the purpose for which the science has been developed, all of them are different, and therefore Indian astronomy is different from other astronomy, is what I said. So then he gave me a visa for 10 years, okay? Then it was not so easy, but anyway, he was convinced with the answer. So the reason why I'm starting with this anecdote is, so I have titled it as uniqueness. See, the uniqueness can be visualized at different levels. In fact, when he made his introductory remark, Kiranji was mentioning that ideas do evolve, but ideas do evolve in a particular context. So the context in which these discoveries have been made in Indian astronomy and mathematics are very different from the context in which they have been discovered in other countries. As a scientist, so one would be interested not only in the final product, but the methodology with which they have been arrived at it. And more interestingly, the uniqueness of this is something which has been sort of praised. So in fact, Dr. Nagaraja Paturi, when he was talking about, he said, we have nourished, but we have nourished this language because it yielded to whatever we wanted to convey through this language. So that is something which is so special about Sanskrit language, and you will be able to find a terminology which will speak for itself rather than coining some terminology which will be very different from what you have to convey through the terminology. So this is something which is so special about this language. I will just tell you about a few things. So one interesting aspect which I wanted to tell you is, this has been conveyed, whether it is mathematics, whether it is Ayurveda, whether it is astronomy, whether it is philosophy, whether it is Natya Shastra, all of them have been beautifully conveyed through a media which is as beautiful as the message that is being conveyed, and that is this versified form. So verses are so enchanting, as they were even when he was saying Tishtub, Banushtub, and so on and so mean. So this is something which is so beautifully analyzed in this land, and they have chosen appropriate meters to convey whatever has to be appropriated, whether it is a complicated formula, or it is a simple arithmetic, or it is infinite series. All of them have been beautifully codified in the form of verses. This is something which is unique to this tradition. And that is possible only because you had this language, which is so polished, which is so systematically developed, and we had a beautiful structure which is called Chanda Shastra, which was available for you to convey the beauty through a beautiful medium. So that is something which is so special. Next, please. Okay, so coming to the purpose, so I wanted to tell you that the purpose was very different. So as far as astronomy is concerned, the purpose of this Shastra was Dik Desha Kala Jnanam. So Dikjnanam is the most fundamental thing, and Deshajnanam, so what do you mean by Desha? Where you are located, and Kalajnanam is of course very important. Now, if I ask this question, how do you know the direction in a particular location? I don't know. Our engineers, so even our institute, they are not able to come up with the answer. You just look at the east and therefore it is east. No. And the second thing that they will say is you have a magnetic compass and then you use it, you will be able to get your directions. Absolutely wrong. So if this were the technology which were employed, then none of the temples, the Chitra Madhavan who was talking before, would have been aligned perfectly so that, I mean, you can predict the date on which the sun is going to directly fall on the idol. None of them is going to work. So there is such a perfection, and this perfection is something which is done with a very, very, very simple tool. So Dikjnanam, the first thing, this starts from Shulva Sutras. Method has been so beautifully delineated there. Then we have Deshajnanam. Unless you know where you are, you will not know when the sun will rise and when the sun will set. People have been seriously interested in finding the duration of the day. So whether it is going to be 10 hours, whether it is going to be 14 hours, depending on where you are, you have to know this. So that is, Desha is extremely important. And of course, Kala, so it is important. Okay. Next, please. Coming to mathematics, there has been a fantastic tradition. In fact, he was mentioning this number 5000. Let me come to that a little later. So this mathematicians have stated, in order to motivate a student to enter into the domain of mathematics, why are you studying this? So there are a beautiful set of verses. It starts with saying, Laukike vaidike chapi tatha samayike piyaha vyaparastatra sarvatra sankhyanam upayujyate. Irrespective of whether you are going to deal with something which is spiritual, whether you are going to deal with something which is mundane, whether you are going to deal with any religious activities, doesn't matter. Sankhyanam upayujyate, without mathematics you cannot go further. And in fact, it starts with Kama Shastra, Artha Shastra, Gandharva Shastra. Gandharva Shastra refers to music and dance. In fact, the rhythm which we were able to experience when Pavitra was dancing here was simply amazing. And when the music was being done, whether it is this music or that music, we have to have a rhythm, the number of beats. And within the given number of beats, how many hits that you are going to make, this is what makes the difference. And in fact, we have an extensively developed shastra which is called Chanda Shastra. In fact, as a pure mathematician, the Pingalacharya, who was there, so at least 2nd century or 3rd century, this is the conservative estimate which these people make. And he has posed the kind of questions which a true mathematician today would pose to himself. So that is something which is remarkable, so that needs to be studied. And in fact, he has developed a certain technique. In fact, Sai Susarala was mentioning. So if you have to compute some number to the power of n, and the technique that this Pingalacharya has given really made many people wonderstruck. So this is something which he has devised a method, though logarithm is not there, but what amounts to doing logarithm is the technique which he has prescribed, by which you will be able to do it in a much simpler way. This is 2200 years ago, at least the conservative estimate. That is what Chanda Shastra is. So Gandharva Shastra, Supa Shastra, even cooking. So you need to know what kind of measure and how much what has to be added. Today everybody has a recipe. Okay. So in those days they will just pick, throw. So that is how it is. Everywhere you have, please proceed further. Next. So finally he says, Bahubhir Vipralapaih Kim Trailokye Sacharachare Yatkinchid Vastu Tatsarvam Ganitena Vina Nahi. So this is the most important motivation that has been provided for anybody to enter into this. So without, today the problem is, so without motivation people have been introduced mathematics, and it is introduced in the most abstract way, and therefore people develop phobia. Yesterday there was a discussion during the dinner session. Myself, Rajesh Srinivasan, and one more person was there. That person was mentioning to me that my daughter has been put in the best school in Delhi, DPA school, but then she had some problem doing arithmetic computation, and therefore I asked her to take a course on Vedic mathematics. And when I went to the teacher and then said I have put my daughter to learn this Vedic mathematics, he said no, he had serious objections, and we had a discussion for almost 1.5 hours. But I could not sort of convince him. I said, you need not be convinced, but anyway, my daughter is benefited because of that, and therefore I want her to study that. So this is what he said. So the point is, so it is something which is very interesting. It's not, let us not debate on the term Vedic. So it is application of algebraic principles to do arithmetic in a simpler way. And this is something which has been a common knowledge for all people. So that which has been commonplace is something which is becoming very rare, and it has been commoditized and it has been commercialized. It is a very sad situation. Today, we are not emphasizing people to learn skills to do arithmetic. This is something which is extremely useful for this person to employ his mind in various other things. So even to multiply 2 into 30, this fellow has to use a calculator. On the other hand, I have seen when I was a schoolboy, I went to the market and then I will go to purchase vegetable. This is about 35 years ago, and that person will handle 5-6 people at the same time, each one purchasing 6-7 items, this quarter kg, and then he will say exactly what the amount is. So the point I am trying to make here is we need to develop certain skills which are essential, and those skills have been presented in a very beautiful way in our text. So instead of teaching very abstract things which may be useful only for a researcher, we have to focus those things which will be extremely useful. That is why he is saying, Bahubhir Vipralapeh Kim Yatki. So Vyavahara, so Digdesha Kala in astronomy, and Vyavahara Ganita is something in mathematics. So these are things which are extremely, next please. With a very simple experiment, you have to have only a small stick. And then with this stick, you will be able to precisely tell the direction, east-west. You have to just make shadow measurements. You will be able to precisely determine the latitude of the place, number 2. You will be able to precisely tell the time also. The formula that you find at the bottom involves sine function, cosine function. In order to determine these functions precisely, these people ultimately developed even the infinite series for sine and cosine. The idea was to make your calculation as precise as possible. That was the whole motivation. So, next please. Kala is, we have, there are 2 views. One is Kala is Anadi Ananta. Anadi Ananta Kala, how are you going to measure? It's not this clock which is going to help. So Kala, there is a beautiful verse there. Yuga varsha masa divasaha samam pravrittastu chaitra shukladehe kaloyam anadyanantaha grahabhaihi anumiyate kshetre. Grahabhaihi anumiyate kshetre. Graha refers to planets, bham refers to star. We refer to the motion of these planets in the background of the star, and that is what precisely determines the duration of whatever time you want to say. Whether it is duration of a day, whether it is a duration of a year, or it is a duration of yuga, whatever be that, it is something which is determined only through this. Our quartz crystals, etc., will not be able to precisely tell, and all the quartz has to be dropped into trash bin provided the earth changes its spin. So what we need to understand is, so these are the things which actually determine what the time is, the duration of a month. Our calendrical system is a beautifully done calendrical system. So you just look at the sky and you will be able to tell what the things are. So that is something which is very interesting to note. The way they have developed this Shastra is this. Next. Next, please. So the science of astronomy itself is called as Kalavidhana Shastram. See, Kalavidhana Shastram is the name that has been given. Earlier we had the name Nakshatra Vidya, and then we have it as Kalavidhana Shastram. So it is not to discover the cosmos, but it is precisely for our Vyavaharika purposes. So that is something which is known through the very terminology. Next. So maybe with this I will just stop because time seems to have got elapsed. So I was just puzzled when our Kiranji was mentioning this is a science which is as old as some 5,000 years. In fact, so yesterday when our Honorable Vice President was talking here, so he was just saying, I have to quote someone who is a Westerner in order to make you believe what it is, right? So I am also quoting this, and just see this. Till 18th century, different civilizations have been trying to make predictions on various astronomical phenomena. And it was something which was remarkable that most of the predictions that were made by the Indian astronomers around that age were yielding precise results. They were able to predict phenomena far more accurately than others could do. So this man, John Playfair, who has written a very interesting article which is titled On the Astronomy of the Brahmins. So this is the title of the article. So it is a 50-page article. He analyzes the entire literature. It is a very long article. Even now I have not thoroughly studied it. But he makes three hypotheses. So if things were predicted correctly, one it is a pure coincidence. But pure coincidence does not happen repeatedly, right? So that has to be discarded. Then he says there must have been a Newton among the Brahmins to discover. So and someone called Leibniz, which means essentially they had the necessary tools, dynamical systems, so which has been so beautifully done by these people. They had the necessary tools which would have helped them in getting, but that was not true. Then the third hypothesis is, see, observations were made in India when all Europe was barbarous and uninhabited, and those made in Europe 5,000 years later. So he was also mentioning about this 5,000 years. So this is something so which we need to understand, so that this is a tradition which has maintained the records verbally for thousands and thousands of years. So there are four pramanas: Smriti, Pratyaksha, Aitihya, Anumana. So these are the four pramanas that we have. All of them have been employed without, even science today does this. So without Aitihya, it doesn't move forward, though it doesn't accept explicitly that Aitihya. So falsifiability is the basis for science today. That is fine. And in fact, even in our tradition, this falsifiability was something which was taken very important. And every astronomer will have a chapter in his text to say, to examine what has been done and what is flawed by the earlier, and therefore I am correcting this. So it's not just taken for granted. It is a pratyaksha shastra. So this is something which is very important. Please go to the last one. Push a lot. proceed. Ah, wait. So just one more point. So to just reiterate what I said. So we have this notion of Rahu Ketu. We have this notion of Prithivi being supported by various things. The astronomer who analyzes this, he says, Kamathadibhi rudrita mahi yadi te kena dhrita nabhasthitaha Atayesham Vyatisthitir Yadi Kshitigolasyatu Kena Varyate. See, the question is, so all these objects which are falling all falling on the earth. Earth is a heavy object, it has to fall somewhere. If you say the Kamatha, tortoise was supporting it, then what supports the tortoise? If tortoise can remain in the space as it is, then why not earth? Okay, next one, and I am stopping there, please. So with respect to eclipses, so you just see the kind of analysis. So he says, Rahu, Ketu, etc. Previous. So Rahu, Ketu, we just say, see, these are two different things. Having some religious practices, observances is very different from having a scientific approach to a particular problem which is being analyzed. So this Rahu, Ketu thing, he says, if Rahu is some body or some disk or some head, etc., who were to do this, then why would this fellow affect the shining of the moon only when the sun and moon are at exactly 180 degrees or exactly at the same point? So this something is not acceptable. Number two, if they were demons, so we will not be able to predict how they are going to behave and when they are going to do this. So it is neither eclipse. So eclipse cannot be understood as something which is caused by a demonic fellow, because we cannot predict our own mind. How can we predict the mind of the demon? And if you are able to predict eclipses, therefore it cannot be caused by this. So this is the kind of sharp analysis which goes on in this literature, which we need to understand. And there are several interesting things, because the time is short. I just conclude here. The point I want to make here is only one thing. So we just think that we are Antha Paramparas, it is all meaningless, stupid. So the most important thing, in fact, when Manjul Bhargava was asked, so he was asked, why, in spite of this famed legacy in India, that we don't produce big mathematicians, the answer that he gave was, what is to be done? So he said, we have to teach Indians what Panini, Pingala, Brahmagupta, Aryabhata, etc. have done. That inspired me, and that will inspire the other people. And till we do this, so this is what is going to happen. So there is nothing wrong in trying to present what is there. There should be no hyperbole, but these are techniques which are very interesting, believe me. And when I teach some of these things to IIT students, I mean, they themselves are quite enthused. It excites them to understand their own scientific heritage. And the same problems have been arrived. This infinite series has been arrived by these people as Newton before 300 years in a different context, in a different methodology. So the simplicity and optimality are something which is remarkable in our tradition. Take it from me. And therefore, it is very essential that we teach some of these things to our young kids, which will definitely make a difference. And China has done in a very, very systematic way. And for the past 30 years, they have been doing. I visited them several times. So this is something, once we do this, I think we will find a change. Thank you very much. Namaskar.